And that broke the ice. Now, 20 years later, we are still really good friends. And in retrospect, when we look back on that time, he said to me that he believes that was the time when we really could talk about some of the tough issues after we had laughed together, because it was going to be a really long tenure if we didn't do that. So I'm asking you to consider humor and how can you build that in, and you know, life's short, and not to get too bent out of shape with these people that can drive us crazy. Because one of the things that attracts us to people, like Paula Abdul saying, opposites attract, you know, those things can drive us crazy after a while.
I'd like you to start the sentence with but. Then I want you to...
I thought the participation with the and the but questions were great to get it. It really puts it in perspective of how you can take, how those words make a very big difference in how you interact with people, and that one word can really change that. And I thought it was a good way to get the whole audience really engaged and really think about it.
I kept being struck by the fact in my coaching and HR roles that introverts were oftentimes misunderstood. The quieter folks at team meetings were overlooked. They were completely ignored, oftentimes in opportunities for promotions, even in hiring. And so this really fascinated me, and it's become really my life's work over the last decade. I'm fortunate to say there is now a movement, the rise of the introverts that we see.
I think probably I learned the most was how to deal with different strategies for dealing with people who are extroverts, and how to help myself in terms of the introvert in me.
We want to paraphrase, right, some other things. Remember that skill of paraphrasing we learned in communication classes? It's an essential skill that's underutilized. And I always advise introverts I work with, paraphrase, because you don't have to come up with something to say right away. You know, how many of you felt in this, you have to go back and forth, right? It's a great tool to use in networking too. You might say things like, when you're discussing with people in conflict, you may be right. Anyone try that one? It's a good one at home. You may be right. You're not saying they're right. You're not definitely. See, now this was worth the price of the conference, right? Totally. You may be right. Or here's another one. Somebody suggested in an interview, they said, I say to my partner, may I offer an alternative opinion? You like that one? Yeah, like these are all good. They're keepers.
Just because we're different doesn't mean we can't work together. And I think that that's true across the entire spectrum of people, that we tend to stay with people we're like. And she gave us some really good reasons why we should look to work with people that we're not like.
Think about breakthroughs are never a function of politeness. The Wright brothers fought like cats and dogs. Anybody know their story? They would argue and then leave their bicycle shop and then take the opposite argument. And people were working on the airplane at the same time that they were, yet they came out the winners. And part of that is attributed to the fact that they disagreed so much. So are you encouraging disagreement?
The fact that she was giving descriptions and examples so that you can really tie the words to understanding what the words mean. That makes a huge difference.
So what is the major difference between introverts and extroverts? It's really about energy, as we've learned in taking these assessments. But to me, it's really emerged as one thing, and that's about the need to take breaks. Introverts will tell you this is not negotiable. If they don't have a break, they melt down. Extroverts say, yeah, breaks are nice, but I don't absolutely need them.
In technology, there's so many introverts and extroverts that it's good to hear ways that we need to approach different people different ways, both in our world of technology as well as we're dealing outside. So it's a nice way to see her approach and kind of get an idea of that there are so many more people out there that we need to be able to interact with better so we can leverage that power of everybody as opposed to just half of the world that is easier to talk to.
Now, this is what's called the walking meeting. So introverts like it, they say, they tell me, and you guys tell me too, because you're not, a lot of times they feel like they're on the witness stand, right? It's like, what do you think? So tell me what's going on, and when's the report due? You know, it's sort of like very aggressive. Extroverts are just expressing themselves, but introverts kind of shut down in that questioning, particularly when you don't answer right away. And what does the extrovert do? They don't like silence, so they ask the next question. Who's the person in your world who is so different from you, but you've learned so much? The person that comes to mind for me is my publisher and editor, Steve Persanti, who on that scale is probably what we might call an extreme introvert. And what Steve has done for me is to really help me be a better thought leader, to challenge me, to push me, and really conceiving of this whole topic. And it's made me a better writer and researcher.
I actually was listening to the book beforehand because it's on Audible also. So it was a good lead into the book. And then the presentation was excellent because I guess I'm kind of the introvert. It was good to hear that different strategies.
I thought that she did an excellent job of bringing together the two different groups and explaining how we could work together. And I live with an introvert. My wife is an introvert. And she gave me some really interesting information about how I'm going to go home and make things better.
So many people don't realize how different everybody's styles are, and getting somebody to help you break down those barriers and to figure out how we interact better is always better.